I want to talk to you about a really cool fishing trip that I had the pleasure of being a part of about a year ago. As many of you know, I love to fish. Fishing is a biblical sport. That's why we're calling this series Hooked. Jesus said, followers fish. Basically, if you're a follower of Christ, you should fish for men. Well, this fishing trip was so unusual that I went on, I wrote it down in my journal, and so I'm going to try to give it back to you exactly the way it happened. I was in Marathon, Florida, in the Florida Keys. Marathon is a small town nestled in that beautiful area. I was fishing with a friend of mine named Scott. Scott and I have fished together for many years. He is one of the best guides I've ever seen in my life. He's a wonderful guy. He has a great family. And the first time I stepped on his boat before this trip, I could tell that he was not a Christian. He sort of had the pushback going on, because when people find out that I'm a pastor, they watch every word and they think about what they're saying, and they're a little bit, whoa, what's this guy going to do, you know, on my boat fishing? Well, we fished for a long time together on the 16-foot boat and had some cool times. And the more I fished with him, the more I just pray, God, you know, you've put us in this boat together for all these hours. Obviously, he's not a follower. And just help me to know what to say, what not to say. Help me to not only fish for fish, but also fish for men. And the cool thing about being a Christian is God says we're to be fishers of men. God's word says that. Become fishers of men, not catchers. God does the catching, we do the fishing. I've thought about fishing a lot and how it relates to the real fishing that God talks about in his word. There are three aspects of fishing, and I was involved in these three aspects on that monumental fishing trip I took with Scott about a year ago. There's the presentation. Whenever you're fishing, you're presenting the bait, you're presenting the lure, you're presenting the fly to the fish. Presentation. Then you got the attraction. You've got to manipulate the fly, the lure, the bait to attract the fish. The fish should go, whoa. You got to get the fish going. Then you've got the reaction. What kind of reaction is the fish having to the bait? Three aspects of fishing. So I found myself this day in the Florida Keys fishing, the presentation, the attraction, hopefully getting a reaction. Then I found myself fishing for men, because as Scott and I began to talk, some really amazing things happened. We were fishing in an area that had a lot of bridges, and you can see the photo of exactly where we were fishing. We were fishing between those two bridges. Scott has sort of grown up in the Florida Keys, and one of those bridges was the famous bridge that Flagler built. It was his dream to build a bridge from Florida all the way to Cuba. Several problems occurred. Number one, he ran out of money. And number two, the great hurricane hit in 1935, killed hundreds of people. So the bridge now is in shambles. So it was very interesting to hear about the history of the bridge. And then we stopped at a little marina, and this marina is called the Old Wooden Bridge. And I thought to myself, I don't see any bridge around here. And Scott said, oh, the old wooden bridge burned. Wow, that's kind of morbid. And he told me about the history of the old wooden bridge. So I was thinking about bridges, and we were talking, and I just really felt a prompting in my spirit. I felt the Holy Spirit of God speaking to me, not in an audible voice, not, Ed, now's the time to talk to Scott. I've never heard God's audible voice. Yet, when the Holy Spirit of God speaks to you, I think many times it's more powerful than an audible voice. I remember 25 years ago when I was praying about whether to come up here and start Fellowship Church or not. I didn't hear God say, this is the spot. I didn't hear him say that. I, though, was on a hill in Irving, and I could take the exact spot. I remember looking over, you know, that area, seeing some apartments and things, the skyline in the distance, and I felt God speak to my spirit, this is the place for you. I want you to help start fellowship. So I have had those moments, and this was a moment. I knew I was supposed to talk to Scott to sort of drill down into his life, because I had talked to him about the things of God before. You know, when it came up, he would ask me questions or whatever. And a real interesting thing happened. He has two beautiful girls, and I told him about Olosso Ranch, and so we arranged to send his oldest to Olosso Ranch. Olosso Ranch is our camp. Really, if you say camp, that's not really what it is. It's more of a retreat center. A camp is like a camp. I mean, Olosso Ranch is like on a whole nother level. Anyway, she went to Olosso Ranch, and she accepted Christ at Olosso Ranch. So when Scott and I were talking, he was like, man, you know, my daughter came home and she said she accepted Christ. Like, he didn't really know what that meant. And so I thought, oh, that's cool. And he talked about how she was getting involved in a student group there in Little Marathon, Florida. So, oh man, that's cool. And I don't know why I had this sense, but I thought, here I've spent all this time with Scott. Hour upon hour in this little 16-foot dolphin skiff. I mean, this skiff is so lightweight, if you don't stay in the center of the skiff, you can fall in. And I've fallen in numerous times. So we're in the skiff, and you know, we're talking and we're going on and on. And I just thought, man, what if Scott died? That sounds kind of morbid, but I thought, what if he died in some boating accident, car wreck? What if he had a heart attack? How would I feel, because I've spent long hours with him, yet I've never really asked him the question, I've never really gotten into what it means in his life to become a follower of Christ. And then I thought, what if I died? I might be the only cog, the only link into his life. Because quite frankly, I don't know, especially then, of any other Christian who knew him well enough to even talk about those things. And you know, I want to ask you that same question. I'm talking to believers. Who's the Scott in your life? Who's that person that you've spent so much time with? Who is that person who has your ear? Who's that person that you're with? I mean, it's not by accident that you know them. Maybe it's someone that you've gone to school with for a long time. Maybe it's someone you work with. Maybe it's someone around the neighborhood, at the club, in the class. Who is your Scott? Because so often we're the only Jesus that people will ever see. And one day, God's gonna ask us, did you fish? Did you fish? Did you present the gospel? Could people see Jesus in your life, the attraction? Did you bring them to a point of decision, reacting one way or another? Those are some heavy questions, aren't they? And with Scott, I just prayed for him regularly. I can show you my prayer journal. Dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of times I prayed for Scott. God, open up doors. I want to walk through them. Give me the words to say to him. And on this day, I knew it. We were talking about bridges. And it's so interesting when you walk with God, how God will point out things that are common, and then boom, you can use them to tell someone about Jesus. And I was speaking words, and it was almost like an out-of-body experience. Because I'm not that smart to come up with this stuff. And so I said, Scott, here we're talking about bridges. Do you know what separates Christianity from all the other religions of the world? He goes, no, not really. I said, the bridge. I said, God build the bridge. He constructed the bridge from his side to man's side. The bridge, Scott, is Jesus. He lived righteously, died sacrificially, rose bodily. So God has built the bridge from himself to us. In fact, I said right before Jesus died, here's what he said. It is finished. The work has been done. The bridge has been built. It's done. He was like, I've never thought about that. I said, think about the other world religions, or think about all the other man-made systems. We try to build bridges to God, being philosophical or being nice or helping charities or being moral. They all fall short. I said, Scott, it's not an accident that we're together. I mean, I'm a pastor, and I've spent all of this time fishing with you. How in the world did we even, pardon the pun, hook up, man? So while I'm fishing out there with Scott, I'm thinking about, okay, I'm fly fishing at the time. I'm throwing a fly, presenting it, the presentation. Then I'm hopefully manipulating the fly to attract fish, and then the fish has a reaction. And the water is so clear there, you can actually see the reaction to the fly. The fish either accepts it or rejects it. On one hand, I was fishing, but no, I was really fishing that day. So as God began to lead and Scott began to describe the change in his daughter's life, I decided to go deeper into the conversation. I'd earned the right to do so. I said, Scott, I want to ask you a question, man, just between me and you. Have you walked the bridge? God built the bridge. The bridge is Jesus. Have you walked the bridge? And he dropped his head. He was like, No. He goes, man, I don't know. I don't know if I have enough faith. I've got some doubts. I said, join the club. I have doubts too. I said, if you don't have any doubt, that means you don't have faith. If you have doubt, you have faith. No doubt means you've got certainty. And with certainty, there's no faith. The just shall live by faith. We're saved by grace through faith. Oh yeah, you got faith. And we were under this bridge, 7-mile bridge, the bridge to the left. It was Africa hot that day. It was so hot, my kneecaps were sweating. And I said, Scott, how many times have we driven on 7 mile in your truck, pulling your boat, and we're going like 60 miles an hour on this 2-lane road. Semis are coming the opposite way. Some idiots are going 80. We're about 10 feet apart. That's faith. I said, we got faith now that we're going to catch some fish. I've got doubts because the tides are all messed up, but I've got faith. I said, yeah, you got faith. I have faith. He goes, yeah, but I have questions about suffering. My mom, and he had a very tumultuous childhood moving back and forth through divorce. He said, my mom has had this excruciating illness for decades. I don't understand how a good God would allow suffering. That's a fair question. I said, Scott, God does not promise us a pain-free life. I mean, think about it. The symbol of Christianity is not a pillow. It's not a cloud. It's not a snuggie. It's a cross. An empty one. It's a cross. If God did not shield, I said, his son from suffering, he's not going to shield you or me from suffering. Part of God's will is suffering. The Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. Obviously, though, we'll have ultimate healing in heaven. But I said, I mean, we're going to have difficult times. And then I told him, I said, Scott, I've had the opportunity to meet a lot of people in my life just by virtue of what I do, I have. And I've noticed people and I've observed people who don't know the Lord, who live for themselves, And I've seen how screwed up their lives are. I mean, ultimately, they'll have some fun, but they come to the end of the hunt and their lives are in shambles. I've also noticed people who've lived the Christian life, and I go, wow, they have something different. I said, even if there was no such thing as heaven, I would live the Christian life. It's the best way to live, but of course we know there's a heaven. But I said, the bottom line, Scott, is have you walked the bridge? But you know what? I can't make you or coerce you to walk the bridge. I'm not going to do that. You have that option. But I want to ask you, man, will you walk the bridge? I said, you've got enough faith. Jesus said, if we have the faith the size of a mustard seed, that's enough faith. And I looked at him and I saw tears coming out from behind his polarized sunglasses. He said, man, I wanna walk the bridge. So right there in the shadow of the 7 mile bridge, and ironically, that island was where he was married. I said, Scott, you're making the most important decision of your life to walk the bridge against the backdrop of where you made the second most important decision when you got married. Right there in the shadows, we prayed, and he walked the bridge, and then we met in the middle of this boat, about to turn it over, gave a bro hug, you know, and he became a follower of Christ. It doesn't get any better than that. It doesn't get any better than knowing God is using you to fish. Are you doing that? Who's your Scott? Who in your life do you need to talk to share with? Who in your life do you need to present the gospel to? Who in your life is being attracted because they see Jesus? Who in your life are you leading to that reaction? That's why I love these bracelets. Man, do you love these bracelets? These bracelets are so fashionable. If you do not have a bracelet, all right, in just a second, I'm going to ask you to lift your hand because we want everyone to get a bracelet. Now, we ordered these bracelets from Alibaba.com, and they love us now. We ordered so many, but last weekend, I think some of you took more than one, maybe 10. That's okay. That's okay. We have an incredible security force, very sophisticated security cameras. We have your name and your face. I'm just playing with you. But anyway, if you don't have a bracelet, I want you to lift your hand because we're going to give you a bracelet. If you already have one, don't take one. But if you don't have one, lift your hand. We'll get you a bracelet. That's right. Everybody needs a bracelet, a fish hook bracelet. There you go. Wow. Man, I love those bracelets. I guess that means that you weren't here last week. What would happen if everybody came to church on one weekend? You know, we have about, 50,000 people that come to our church at least once every month? Is that crazy? Once every... No, don't clap. No, don't clap. That's bad, see? Once a month ain't gonna do it. What if I said, I'll only eat once a month. I'll only work out once a month. I'll only be intimate with my spouse once a month. No, I'll only go to school once a month. No, that's not good. Thanks for clapping. I guess it impressed you. 50,000, yeah. I guess that impressed you, but that's okay, but not that great. The bracelet, the hook bracelet. What is the hook? The hook is the gospel. What's the gospel? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. So put the hook bracelet on, wear it. The hook binds everything together. We're gonna go through the colors. The colors mean something. God is a God of color, did you know that? Not of black and white. Once you walk the bridge, you'll move from black and white to color. God's a God of what? You know what? How about the rainbow after the Noachian flood? The rainbow, rainbow of colors. Read about how God designed the temple over in the Old Testament, all about colors. How about Joseph? He wore a coat of many colors. Color, color, color. I'm glad we can see in color. Black. Well, that's not a color because black is the absence of color. Say black with me. Black means sinfulness. Sinfulness, the absence of color. The Bible says, and this is around our wrist, that we all sin. I'm a natural born sinner. My sins, the Bible says, separate me from God. I'm separated from God because of my what? Sinfulness. I've never taken personal lessons on how to sin. I just know how to lie. I know how to cheat. I know how to think impure thoughts, and so do you. Sin separates us from God. So the darkness is like, man, I can't see my hand in front of my face. It's that dark. God is holy. He's just. He's righteous. Yet we chose to rebel against God, causing this cosmic chasm. This chasm that we cannot bridge. This chasm that we cannot jump over. This chasm always falls short. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have sinned and, say it with me, fall short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. And the Bible also says our iniquities, our sins have separated us from God. Isaiah 59, verse 2. So black means sinfulness. Say it again. Black means? How about red? Oh, red's the good news, man. It's bad, but it's good. Red stands for forgiveness. Red stands for? That's what I thought you said, forgiveness. We don't deserve forgiveness. I don't deserve it. You don't. We deserve eternal separation from God. Yet God is a God of love. God chose to do what? To build the bridge from his side to man's side. The bridge is? Jesus. The bridge is?
Jesus.
Yeah, pretty much anytime I ask you a question, the answer is Jesus. Yeah. The Bible is about?
Jesus.
Okay, there we go. That's right. It is. It is. It is. So Jesus did something. He lived a perfect life. We say, oh man, that was righteous. Righteous is who Jesus is. The righteousness of God is seen in his character, in his attributes. Read about the laws mentioned in Scripture. Read about who God is. Totally and completely righteous. And God says, if you're righteous, if you're perfect, you can get into heaven. I mean, if you're perfect, no impure thought, no bad mood, no off day, no sin of commission or omission. If you're perfect, God says, when you die, come on into heaven. Uh-oh, but the Bible says all have sinned. So we got a sin problem. I've got a sin problem. My sins have separated me from God. But God built the bridge from his side to our side. Jesus lived righteously. Then he spilled his blood on the cross for the sins of the world. There's something within us. When something bad happens, we say, somebody's got to pay. Somebody has got to pay. God has placed that in our lives. Somebody's got to pay for your sins and mine. Jesus paid it all. Is that awesome? He paid it all. I don't care what you've done, what you're doing, what you will do. Jesus paid it all. He shed his blood on the cross. Life is in the blood. And the Bible says in 1 John 1, 9, if we confess our sins, you know what confession means? Agreeing with God. It's not like we confess our sins and God goes, whoa, thank you for telling me that. Thanks for giving me the 411. No. We're agreeing with him. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just and will what? Forgive us our sins and purify us from what? All unrighteousness. How about gold? Gold. People say, man, you're golden. You're golden. You know what gold represents? Gold represents righteousness. What is righteousness? The word righteousness means to be right with God. So if I'm righteous, I'm what? Right with God. But Ed, I'm not following you, man, because how can I be right with God if I'm a sinner? Jesus has made us right with God. Jesus has made us righteous. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. God made him who had no sin, that's Jesus, to be sin for us, so that in him, let's say it together, we might become the righteousness of God. Check this out. This is so, so critical. When God sees you and sees me now, if we've walked the bridge, when God sees Scott now, he sees the righteousness of Jesus. Jesus fulfilled the law perfectly. He satisfied God's demands precisely. When we become followers of Christ, the righteousness of Christ is attributed to our lives. Are you with me? Just nod your head. Yeah, in Miami, are you with me? Yeah. Dallas, okay. South Lake, are you with me? Right. Okay, London, are you with me? All right. We receive the righteousness of Christ. So now, it's not because of what I've done, it's because of what Jesus did. I've walked the bridge and now I'm righteous. So isn't that cool? Black, sinfulness. Red, forgiveness. Gold, righteousness. So I look at my wrist and go, man, I'm awesome because of you, Jesus. And then green represents fruitfulness. Green represents, that's what I thought you said, fruitfulness. So we're to grow. So what happens when you plant something? What do you do with that something? You water it. After we walk the bridge, we need to get watered. We need to get baptized. Maybe you were baptized like my wife was. Maybe you were sprinkled. Maybe you were spritzed. Maybe you were poured. I don't know. The Bible says after we become followers of Christ, we're to be baptized. Part of growth is being baptized. Part of growth is understanding the word, talking to God in prayer, involving yourself in church. That's why we have the growth tracks, class 101, 201, 301, 401. And today, we're teaching class 401. You can join the class whenever you want. We'll take care of your kids. It's part of what? Growing. Living things grow. If you've walked the bridge, you need to liquidate. Get baptized. And we're baptizing today. If you've never been baptized, why not? I mean, seriously, why not? Well, my hair. I don't know what to wear. We'll give you a baptismal uniform. But my car, if I decide to get baptized in my clothes, I might get the Corinthian leather wet. We got covers for your seats. We got the most beautiful place ever to be baptized at all of our different campuses. So we're going to baptize some of you, you know, in a couple of minutes. What a great time to get baptized. Man. You remember Simon Peter? We talked about Simon Peter last week. Simon Peter preached this message. And after the message, people were like, what do I do? Because they'd walked the bridge. He said, repent and get baptized. And then he said, once you do that, you'll understand, and I'm paraphrasing now, what life is all about. And then the Bible says this. On that day, say that day with me, 3,000 were baptized. Okay, how can I make this day that day? Get baptized. Because many people are going to walk the bridge. We've had so many people walk the bridge in all of our services here and at all of our different campuses. It's been just a great, great day. After you walk the bridge, you need to get baptized. And maybe you've walked the bridge before, but you've not gotten baptized. It's time for you to get baptized. So, do you understand the colors now? Are you feeling the colors? Are you loving the colors? And the hook is what holds everything together. I love this text. Colossians chapter 1, verse 17. He is before all things, he being Jesus, and in him all things hold together. The hook. The hook is the gospel. The bait is Jesus. This rope, the thread that holds everything together, the gospel. Black sinfulness, red forgiveness, gold righteousness, green fruitfulness, living things grow. The Bible says in 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus. I'll ask you the same question I asked Scott. Have you walked the bridge? Well, man, I've got doubts. Cool. It's part of faith. You live by faith. Have you walked the bridge? I pray you walk the bridge. Because it's the best step you'll ever take. And it's what being hooked is all about. Would you bow your heads with me here and in all of our different campuses? I'm going to pray a prayer right now. And this is a prayer that I led Scott in 13 months ago when he walked the bridge. And just repeat this prayer after me. Just say, God, I admit to you that I'm a sinner. I admit to you that I've fallen short, that I've done life my own way. I understand that I'm separate from you because of my behavior. But I believe that you shed your blood on the cross for my sins. And I understand right now that you've done that, and I receive you, Jesus, into my life. I turn from my sins and I receive you. Wash me, forgive me, cleanse me. Many of you are saying that right now, and here's what's happening. The righteousness of Jesus is being attributed, is being grafted, it's being imputed into your life right now. You're born again. You're a new creature in Christ. You've walked the bridge. And now green, let's grow together. This is a place of growth, fellowship. This is a place that's dynamic. This is the place where you can put your roots down. So it's time for many here, after you've said that prayer, to get baptized, because Jesus commands it. He commands it. So Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your grace, and we thank you for this moment of decision. We ask all these things. As our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, no one looking around, if you prayed the bridge prayer with me and meant it, would you lift your hand if you prayed that prayer with me? Hands going up everywhere. Awesome, I got you, man. All these hands. Great. Here, yes. And I'm being told, and I know at all of our different campuses. Here's what I'm gonna challenge you to do. When I close this prayer down in a couple of seconds, when I say amen in a couple of moments, we're all gonna stand to our feet here and at all of our different churches. If you want to get baptized today, and I would definitely encourage you to get baptized because you've walked the bridge, I'm gonna ask you, when we stand, you just walk forward and we'll take you out and take you to our dressing areas and show you what baptism means. It'll take just a couple of moments, and then we'll baptize you at our different campuses. So I'm gonna ask you, to come forward. I know it's not easy, but we're doing what Jesus said. Baptism represents your old life and your new life. You're identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Don't put it off. You come forward. It's part of your growth. It's part of watering that seed that Jesus has planted in your life. So don't delay. Get ready. I'm about to say amen. One, that's right. Two, three. Everyone stand and you come forward only as He leads. You come forward. Let's give it up for these coming forward to be baptized. You guys just come right out. Awesome. Don't delay. I know it's not easy. Anyone else? Anyone else? Anyone else? From way in the back, you come down. All right. You keep coming. There's others who are still coming. There's others who are still coming. Wow. Wow. Anyone else? All right.